Hello and welcome to Executive Decision, where every week we go face to face with key economic leaders, business leaders and thought leaders on the state of the Indian economy, which is now reeling from twin challenges of already slowing growth and now, in a sense, the COVID slowdown. Joining me on the show is someone who perhaps can give us a clue as to what is the way out, and that is Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman of NITI Aayog, the government's premier economic think tank. Thank you very much indeed, Rajiv Kumar, for joining us. Now, you are joining us on a day when we have had, literally in the past 24 hours, two big announcements, two big measures. We've had the big Prime Minister's package for the poor, and we've also had the RBI now come in with some measures. And let me start off with the PM Garib scheme, because obviously that affects a lot of people, many more people. And let me just start by asking you, Rajiv Kumar, that while, of course, this was very much needed and there are some excellent measures in it, but one question is that was it left a little too late? Shouldn't it have been done earlier to prevent this huge dislocation of the poor, millions of them either on their way back to villages or perhaps even stranded in the middle?
Vasu, glad to be here on your channel. And sorry to start off on a wrong foot, which is saying that why exaggerate things when they shouldn't be exaggerated? Millions are not on the road. Millions have not been relocated. You know, there were scenes before that, before the Prime Minister's announcement that had happened. But since the Prime Minister's announcement, you know, there have been some movement, of course, and I'm told even by foot, etc.
Yes.
But I've inquired on several occasions from several sources that they are thankfully still in hundreds and not even in the thousands. And the question about whether, just a minute, and the question about whether this should have come earlier, it couldn't have possibly come earlier before the Prime Minister's announcement, because that was the trigger, and it came within 36 hours of the Prime Minister's announcement. I think that was not too long a time taken for such a major announcement.
But I want to ask you why, but Rajiv Kumar, when you said it couldn't come before the Prime Minister's announcement, I'm trying to understand why, because the Prime Minister's announcement was meant to ensure that everybody stays where they are. As he said, that your house becomes a Lakshman Rekha, you're not supposed to cross. But what has ended up happening is, as a result of the announcement, is that large numbers of people, because suddenly they found themselves out of work and with no clear sense of where they were going to get their next meal from, have had to move and shift. Now, you could debate over how many are still on the road or not, but there's no doubt that huge numbers have had to shift from cities and towns to villages. Had this announcement been done earlier, perhaps they may have had reason to stay.
So this is, I think you've got the causality wrong, I'm afraid. Because had the announcement become earlier, that would have become the announcement. And that would have created a panic because people wouldn't know as to why this announcement is being made. You've got a clear reason now. The Prime Minister has requested everybody to stay indoors where they are. Hmm. The Prime Minister said has requested with folded hands people to have patience and to abide with us. And then within 36 hours, the Finance Minister announces the welfare package, the relief package, which you know is quite substantial. Now, the fact is that,
yes,
the transmission of all of this,
yes,
the implementation of all of this does take time in any system, especially in ours where we have a complex polity and economy like we do. But I'm sure that this will improve in the days to come. It is already improving and people will stay where they are.
Okay. Let me not further debate you on that, because it's more important that we look at the package itself. Now, there are some excellent measures in the package. I think one of them is, of course, the enhancement of food under the public distribution system. So to double the outlay of food, to throw in a kg of pulses is excellent. But the question that does remain, the two big questions, the first one is that the concern is that this package doesn't target those who are immediately in need. These are daily wagers, these are migrant laborers, these are people like thela walas and so on, who have been very, very severely impacted by the slowdown. And they, because they fall into an informal part of the economy, they may not necessarily be linked to government schemes, bank accounts and so on. How does this scheme help them? They need cash in their pockets urgently, and it's not clear how the scheme is providing that.
Yeah, Vasu, let's get the numbers right. I think it's important to go into that sort of detail. The announcement about the enhanced food ration, the finance minister said, covered 80 crore people.
Yes.
That already they are there, right?
Yes.
Then you have, you will agree, the top 20% of our population, which is about, let's say, 30 odd crores of 130 crore population, which does not need this. Yes?
Yes,
so it leaves,
of course.
So it leaves really just about, at most about 8 to 10 crore distributed all over the country, which may be classified in the nature of migrant workers. Mm-hmm. You know, who have, and this is, I would put it to you that what the number that I've just told you is a very exaggerated number. The migrant worker, which is away from home and located somewhere else,
yes,
that's the one, and is on daily wage. Mm-hmm. Now, that's a very small set. And for that, the district authorities are moving to connect with the, you know, with the CSR systems, with the charitable organizations, with the NGOs, to provide them means of sustenance where they are.
Okay.
And what I want to request you and your channel, therefore, is
to
encourage people, everybody, to stay where they are rather than get into a mass movement. So that would be the worst thing for preventing the spread of the virus.
But you know, just one point on your estimation of the unorganized labor force. Now, the Indian Express this morning, I don't know if you had a chance to see, wrote a piece where they said that a decade back, strength of the unorganized sector force stood at 47.4 crores, according to the NSSO's Employment and Unemployment Survey 2011-12.
Vasu, but the unorganized sector is also covered by the PDS scheme.
Right.
The informal sector may not be covered by EPFO or by ESI, but the PDS scheme has reached much, much wider. Than the formal sector, you know. So those numbers are just incomparable.
Okay, let's now actually look at those who are actually going to be receiving these benefits. What are they getting apart from the food, which is, as I said, important and necessary? But the main thing is cash in the pocket, because that's the crucial thing. That suddenly their incomes have stopped or virtually collapsed. Now, in terms of cash in the pocket, Mr. Rajiv Kumar, do you think the government could have been a bit generous? Because when you're offering, for example, Jandhan ladies with Jandhan accounts, offering them 1,500 rupees over 3 months, that's 500 rupees a month. Or pensioners and widows who are getting, again, 1,000 rupees over 3 months, that's, you know, 300 rupees. 500 to 300 rupees a month at a time like this?
Yeah. I wish we were as rich as the U.S., you know, and could do a $2 trillion package, you know, because but the point is that one has to live within one's means, as it were, right? And you know, because I know that I've answered this question in other channels, which is that if you give any other number, even for this number, the question is being raised, where are you going to get the money from? And I have been at pains to say that, look, this is not the time to count your money and to do your sums in that regard. So, you know, the government has to balance, you know, a sense of fiscal rectitude along with the help that they can give to the people concerned. Now, of course, the larger amount that we can give, the better we are in this case. And I agree with you. But this will, you know, this is the start, as the finance minister herself said.
Okay.
And I'm sure, eventually it is seen to be insufficient, it will be topped up. Please also remember that many state governments, many state governments have already added to this by their own schemes and their own announcements, which will go there, you know, which will also
of course they have.
Add to the cash.
Of course they have.
You have to look at the totality, yeah?
No, that's true. Of course they have. But the expectation was that this was a time for the center, because you've been very bold when it came to the lockdown, the Prime Minister announcing very, very bold sweeping measures. But there is a sense that when it came to the financial response, the government has been more timid. But you say you have to live within your means. You say you have to live within your means. Now, that may well be a fair point or a debatable point.
But can I just ask you?
Yes.
Can I just interrupt you here?
Yes.
See, the Prime Minister's announcement about the lockdown
has
no alternative. There is no vikalp in that. That's
right.
The only way forward. So, you know, which you cannot say about the amounts that can be put in people's pocket. But please also remember that you have to tot up the financial costs of the extra 5 kilos of grain and 1 kilo of pulses.
Oh, yes. I'm not taking away from that. And in fact, that comes to 45,000 crores, which is a substantial chunk of the package. But as I said, leaving that aside, I was looking at simply cash in pocket, cash in the hand, which is very, very important. But let me ask you, sir, about the actual design of it, because there are some aspects of it. I mean, one, of course, is the amounts. The other is the NREGA enhancements, which in any other time would be welcome. But there is no NREGA right now. Most states have either formally or informally shut it down.
The lockdown will hopefully be lifted soon enough on the 15th. And then the NREGA employees will get the larger wage, which I think is a good announcement.
NREGA enhancement is supposed to be benefiting them now, during the lockdown. That's the whole idea. But there is no NREGA work.
But all these people also have their Jandhan accounts to which some money would be given. Now, you see, I'm not sure whether the NREGA amount cannot be distributed to these people as direct benefits for work that they can do from home. You know, there is something that they can do, which is, you know, I suppose so. Look, it's a fair point that you've raised. I've not looked into it, and I will look into the design of the NREGA distribution after our conversation.
Okay, that would be wonderful, actually. That would be wonderful if the NITI Aayog can look at perhaps persuading states to revive NREGA work, you know, following, of course, safety measures.
That's the key. Let's not for a minute miss the fact that the key requirement is for the moment to stop the spread of the virus.
Maintain the social distance. But it would be wonderful if you could look at that.
Yes, of course I will.
I do want to ask you, though, that I'm sure that, you know, the inputs or the suggestions of the NITI Aayog would not have been missing in whatever came out. How much can you share in terms of, like, this particular, the package or the outline of the whatever came out? Was this along the lines of what you would have suggested or what you would have liked to see?
Look, all of us have worked on it together. We have all sent in our inputs. Mm-hmm. And I think when the government works as a whole. And we don't distinguish between one agency or the other. I think that, with due respect, that question is a bit moot.
Okay. Fair enough. And I suppose there's only that much you can tell me on national television. But now, coming to the RBI, so I think there's been generally across the board, you know, fairly positive responses to the fact that the RBI has slashed the rates at which it both lends to banks as well as borrows from banks. So that's good. But at this time, do you see any benefits of that accruing, given the fact that there's not much financial activity?
Oh, the biggest benefit, I can tell you, Vasu, and been consulted with a fairly large number of industry representatives, is that the businesses will be free from servicing their debt for the next 3 months. This would have represented an outgo right at the big end of this month or the beginning of next month, and that would have created a huge cash crunch. And all of them, without fail, all of them, looking, this is one relief that they want, because that will help them conserve liquidity, which will help them to meet their variable costs, you know, which are required to keep their businesses just ticking over in this time of, lockdown, so that they can come back and restart their business when the lockdown is lifted.
So that's
an immediate relief.
You're talking here about the moratorium. You're talking about the three-month moratorium.
Which is a part of the RBI package that is
announced. Absolutely. I was actually going to come to that, but since you brought it up, it is, again, it's a wonderful move, but there is a bit of a question mark over whether this is something which is binding on the banks, because what the RBI said is that it, in a sense, gives a green light to the banks to offer a three-month moratorium, a waiver of loans. So does that mean the banks will have to do it, or is it left to their discretion?
Three things, Vasu. One, I should have thanked you for recognizing how good the two packages have been. I do so now. Thank you. I mean, that's wonderful coming from you. Second, when the regulator advises
others should follow. The regulator cannot and should not decide on part of the regulatees. Okay. So it will be the boards of each of the banks which will take this decision. And I feel rather assured that when the regulator has said that, look, this moratorium will not sound to your quality and will not degrade your etc., they would, each bank board will do it. It is for them to do it. That's how the process should be and is. And the third point that I wanted to make is that I hope you will point out that this includes the EMR to be paid by those who got home loans. And that will be relief to the middle class for them to come around. And, you know, and that's the one to actually help them conserve their liquidity, which will take a little bit of a beeping during this time.
Right. I think... sir, I'll tell you, of course, when you say that the RBI gives an advisory or passes, orders is not the right word, but when they make such announcements...
That's exactly what I'm trying to say.
I'm saying, hold on. I think, obviously, it would be perfect if, from whatever advice comes or guidance comes from the RBI is followed. But as you know, often that doesn't happen. Even when they do slash... what are called repo rates, banks don't necessarily pass that on to customers. And so there is some amount of apprehension in the public mind about whether the moratorium is actually going to be passed. I mean, whether banks will act on the moratorium. So
let me use this opportunity to give the assurance to the viewing public that such advice coming from the regulator is normally followed, and in these particular circumstances, is most likely to be followed by boards which are undoubtedly autonomous agencies. So the second issue that I wanted to raise is that the Reserve Bank has also done an incredible thing by reducing the reverse repo rate by 90 basis points, which encourages the bank not to park their surplus cash in the RBI, but to lend it out, to give it to
right.
them.
So just to clear, just to clarify to your viewers, the reverse repo rate is the rate at which banks lend to the RBI, and that's the rate at which the RBI borrows from banks. So by reducing that, then you don't give an incentive to banks to necessarily park their money with the RBI. So the RBI has reduced both. Let me just. Ask you sort of in conclusion, though, Rajiv Kumar, that overall, because as I said at my introduction, that India was already in somewhat of a sort of a worrying path economically even before the slowdown hit. Now, where do you see this ending up? What kind of, is it even possible to do a forecast for what this would do to growth rates? CRISIL says we might have to downward revise to anywhere between 3.5% to 4%.
Well, I can't be braver than Governor RBI and his Monetary Policy Committee. And if you remember what he said, this is one occasion where the Monetary Policy Committee has not chosen to do any forecast for the GDP in the coming year, 2021.
Okay.
And I think given the huge uncertainties facing us, both domestically and moreover in the global market, because the whole thing is just completely, sort of up there, as it were.
Right.
It'll be a very, very brave person. I actually admire CRISIL or whatever agency to have been brave enough to say what they have said.
Okay.
And I just leave it at that.
Okay, fair enough. I think, as you said, it's perhaps, too much of a roll of the dice to start looking at where the growth path will take us. But thank you very much indeed, Rajiv Kumar, as always, for joining us and taking
your
questions. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Basu, for having me. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Okay.